Let's pray. Father, we give you thanks, praise, and glory for the privilege of worship through the study of the Word. We bless your name. We acknowledge your presence. We empty ourselves vessels for your use. We yield to your Holy Spirit now. We ask that you anoint your people with eyes to see and ears to hear. Anoint your servant with your word. As we empty ourselves now, vessels for your use. In your name we pray. We bind you, Satan, all territorial spirits, all principalities, powers, rulers, wicked spirits in high places, territorials, elementals, and surveillance and reporting and recording spirits, the strong men on assignment, all familiars, ancestrals, disembodied spirits, all that project, all on assignment. We are loosed. You are cast out. In the name and by the blood of Christ Jesus, the saints said in agreement, amen.
Amen.
Well, we have been talking over the past several sessions about understanding the book of Hebrews. And in chapters 1 and 2, we learned about the preeminence of Christ and the plan of Christ. And we went on to chapter 3 in our last session, which talked about or gave us the introduction to entering God's rest. In the last verses, 18 and 19 of chapter 3, we read, "And to whom did he swear that they should not enter his rest, but to those who were disobedient? And so we see that they were not able to enter because of unbelief." Now here, the Lord was speaking of Israel, and notice that in this particular writing, Paul writes this epistle to the Hebrews, in which he expounds to them, as we see in chapter 4 to come, that it is quite possible yet for them to enter into God's rest. And so the subject of the chapter which we are going to be discussing tonight, the theme of this chapter is entering God's rest, and in particular, what it means to enter God's rest, and also how it is obtained. You know, there's a heretical teaching in the church now that says that it is not possible for Israel to enter God's rest because they rejected Messiah. And now God has raised up the church and is going to do everything through the church, and the church has taken the place of Israel or has been substituted by God for Israel. Nothing could be farther from the truth. That's heresy. And if you hear that kind of a teaching, walk away from it as quickly as you can, because there is no such thing as Israel being displaced by the church. God relates to Jew and Greek, Romans 1 says, Jew and Gentile, Romans chapter 2 says. And so we understand that how he relates to the Jew is different from how he relates to the Gentile, but the gospel is one and the same for each. Now, why is that? Because he is doing a different work with the Jew than he is with the Gentile. You see? And he is, however, raising a remnant from both, isn't he? Okay? So here, when Paul made those comments in Hebrews 3, verse 18 and 19, stating that Israel did not enter into God's rest, that the reason they did not enter into God's rest was because of disobedience and unbelief. That actually refers to us today as well. Why? Because God is not a respecter of persons. Huh? Now, what does that mean? That means he has no favorites. Huh? And what he does for one, he will do for all. Huh? So let's begin our study now. We're going to go on to Hebrews 4, beginning with verse 1. It reads, "Therefore, let us fear, lest while a promise remains of entering his rest, any one of you should seem to have come short of it." Now, the first thing you need to look at is the words, "Therefore, let us fear." Paul here is talking to his fellow Israelites, to the Jew. Okay? And notice his remark. While a promise remains of entering his rest, in other words, even though they had rejected Christ, there still is the ability for them to enter God's rest. There is still the ability for them to do that, but there is a way in which they must go about it, which he expounds on and describes as we go on here. Okay? But the point he is trying to dispel is the idea that it is no longer possible for them to enter God's rest. See, God's covenant is unilateral. That means it comes from God to man. And God had a covenant, huh? And he said in Psalm 89, "My covenant I will not break." Right? Now there he was talking about David, huh? Okay? But the same goes for Israel, doesn't it? Because he's not a respecter of persons. "My covenant I will not break," you see? Now, why is it a unilateral covenant? Because it is a covenant in his blood. See? So, God has a covenant, and even though Israel failed to receive him and, in fact, rejected him, huh? Okay? Because that's the history of man. Do you remember me teaching you that? Israel rejected the Father. Judah rejected the Son. The church rejected the Holy Spirit after Pentecost. Huh? You all remember that? Okay, that's the history of man. Huh? When they got into sin, Israel went to the elders and they said, "We're always getting in trouble with God. Give us a system of kings and judges to rule over us. Write down what you want us to do and God will stop punishing us." That's actually what they said. And so God gave them the law. See? And he said to the elders of Israel, "Israel has rejected me." Right? 1 Samuel 8:7. Israel has rejected me. Why? Because by saying, "Give us a system of kings and judges to rule over us," they were saying, "We want to be ruled over by man. We want to be man-led, not spirit-led." So Israel rejected the Father. So God, out of grace, see, the operation of grace was always present in the Old Testament. Okay, and how do you see it? Well, very simply, God, out of his grace, sent Jesus. Huh? And they bring, Judah brings Jesus before Pontius Pilate. Huh? And confesses before Pontius Pilate, "We have no king but Caesar." So Judah rejects the Son. Huh? And then God, out of grace again, sends the Holy Spirit at Pentecost. Right? And in the year 325 AD, Constantine establishes the Catholic Church, right? And denominationalism begins, which says to the Holy Spirit, "Israel's same sin. We want to be man-led, not spirit-led." So they went around in a circle. So the history of man is one of rejecting God. See? Even of the so-called believers. You see? So the point I'm trying to make to you is that the reason that Paul in Hebrews 4:1 begins with "let us," Okay, fear, lest while a promise remains of entering his rest, any one of you should seem to have come short of it. The reason he makes that statement was because the gospel had already been preached to the Jews. And because it had been preached to the Jews, there had been an understanding among the, some of the Jewish believers that it was too late for them to come into the kingdom because Israel had rejected Christ as Messiah. Now, why had they rejected Christ as Messiah? Well, the reason was because they were looking for a political Messiah to deliver them from Rome. And along comes Jesus, who's a spiritual Messiah, and he says, my kingdom is not of this world. Okay? And so the Jews concluded he can't possibly be the one. See? So they missed their Messiah. Now, here, Paul is addressing this issue. And what he's trying to make them see is that, no, it is not too late. That entering God's rest is still available to them. That's the whole point of chapter 4. Okay? Now, before we go on, let's look at this issue, or these words, entering God's rest. If you actually study the original Greek manuscripts, you will discover that the word rest is not in the manuscript at all. It's entering in. Say, the King James translators took the liberty, if you will call it that, to put entering in God's rest, or entering God's rest. But the actual Greek manuscript talks about entering in, say. And the word rest itself is not mentioned, okay? Now, entering God's rest, and the reason we use the translated term, or this term, which is really a liberty of translation of the King James translators, the reason we use that translation is because it has become so widely accepted in the church at large. You see, and if you talk about entering in, many people are going to scratch their head and wonder what you're talking about. So for practicality, we will use the term entering God's rest. Now the next point is, what does that mean? What is entering God's rest? Well, entering God's rest by definition is being at peace with God. Okay? Now, being at peace with God by definition is what? Salvation. See? Okay? Now, notice this. The word, when we receive salvation, Christ's righteousness is imputed to us. It's credited to our account. Huh? His righteousness. Okay? And you heard me say before that the word righteousness comes from the old English right wiseness. Or right wisdom. Okay? Right wiseness. Which means right standing with God in the Old English. Right wiseness meant right standing with God, being in right relationship with God, you see? So the idea that in salvation his righteousness is imputed to us, credited to our account in heaven, okay, puts us in right standing with the Father. Why? Because nothing will do as far as the Father, you know, for us to be accepted by the Father, nothing will do other than the requirement to be in perfect relationship with him, which is what? Matthew 5:48, be perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. Well, we have a problem, don't we? Because we are not perfect, are we? Okay? Now, the scripture says, the life is in the blood. So, in the blood of Jesus, who is perfect, because he is one with the Father, is perfect life. Say? And perfect righteousness, which is credited to our account. So, here I am with my sin, but I am now justified and covered by the blood of Jesus. Let this be the blood of Jesus. Father God looks down. Does he see me with my sin? No. What does he see? The righteousness in the perfect life of Christ upon me. Say, it covers me. In other words, Father God says, come up. See how it's done? In other words, that's the doctrine of justification. That's called. Say, and the doctrine of sanctification is that Christ sanctifies us by his blood, which washes away all of our sin. Huh? Now, this is what Israel missed. And a number of them had become concerned because now they had heard the gospel at a time when Israel had already rejected the Savior. And so they thought it was no longer possible for them to enter into his rest. They thought it was no longer possible for them to receive salvation. They thought it was too late for them. See? So Paul here says, let us fear lest while the promise remains of entering his rest. While the promise remains. While the promise remains. In other words, Paul is saying to the Jews, it is still possible to enter his rest, but you must do it Christ's way. See? So he goes on in verse 2 and he says, for indeed we have had good news preached to us, just as they also, he's talking about the Jew, but the word they heard did not profit them, because it was not united by faith in those who heard. Oh. See? In other words, they didn't receive it by faith. See, if they received it, that would have been God's grace. How? Through faith, through trust. Faith is trust. Huh? But he says, they did not profit them because it was not united by faith for those who heard. Say, so what was it that they did? They were in unbelief, so they tried to do it by law. Say, and the law was not acceptable, was it? Because you couldn't get saved by law. Because if you broke one, you broke them all. And there were 613 laws to keep, right? And it did not profit them, but they had memorized the law. They had written the law and copied the scriptures. They knew it backward and forward, and they could quote the law. Okay? But it couldn't save them, huh? You can know the law. Say, listen, a Florida state trooper could stop you on the turnpike, okay? And you can roll down your window, and he can ask for your license. And you can say, well, officer, according to Florida statute number 378, subsection number 1220, it says, you shall not speed, and I guess I've sped, so I repent, and I'm sorry, but will that deliver you from a ticket? It won't deliver you from a ticket, even though you have quoted the law and you knew the law, backward and forward. You see? Well, it doesn't matter if it's state law, or if it's civil law, or if it's scriptural law. Law is law. That's the point that Paul tries to make, and he also, in this verse, and he also tries to make that point in the book of Galatians, that you cannot be under law and under grace at the same time. You must either be under law or grace, But you cannot be under law and grace. God is not in it. See? So here he says, they missed it because the word they heard did not profit them, because it was not united by faith in those who heard. In other words, they had tried to do it by law. See? Verse 3. For we who have believed entered that rest, just as he has said, as I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest, although his works were finished from the foundation of the world. Now, look at the beginning of that verse. For we who have believed entered that rest. Here's something you need to know. In the New Testament, the word believe, the word faith, and the word trust are all interchangeable. They all mean the same thing, trust. The word believe in the New Testament does not mean intellectual belief or intellectual understanding. Oh, I believe George Washington existed because the history books tell me that he existed. I believe George Washington existed the way I believe Jesus Christ existed. See, that's an intellectual belief. When the New Testament scripture uses the word believe, okay, it doesn't mean an intellectual appreciation. It means trust. Transferring your trust from yourself to Jesus to do it for you. See? You know the illustration that I've given you before, where I've said that you can intellectually believe that that chair will hold you. Huh? Okay? And this is the difference between the faith that justifies and the religious intellectual faith that does not justify. See, I can stand here and I can look at this chair and I can say, well, this chair will hold my weight. I believe this chair will hold my weight. See? Now notice that while I'm doing that, I'm depending on myself and my two legs to hold my weight, aren't I? See? But I can say, I know that this chair will hold my weight. See? But that's not true. You presume that the chair will hold your weight, because you can never know that the chair will hold your weight until you transfer your trust from yourself and your own two legs to do it to putting yourself in the chair and letting the chair hold you up. Say, transferring your trust from yourself to the chair to do it. Now make the chair Jesus. And you understand what the type of trust or faith is that justifies you for salvation. You see? It's all of him and none of me. See? That's exactly right. All of him and none of me. See? That's the kind of trust that they failed to enter into. See? Now, so when he uses in verse 3, for we who have believed, see, we who have trusted, we who have transferred our trust from ourselves to him, we enter that rest. Just as he has said, I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest, although his works were finished from the foundation of the world. See, he had already set up the way for them from the foundation of the world. Okay? But they still refused to trust. Okay? And he had also given them the grace to trust, right? Because his way was always grace through faith, huh? Right from the beginning of the Old Testament, it was grace through faith, huh? God went to Abraham, that's grace, huh? And it says Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. That's faith, believe, trust. Trust is faith. See? So Abraham, an Iraqi, okay, was the father of the Jewish nation. Does God have a sense of humor? See? Isn't that something? Okay, and he did it, how? By grace through faith. So God had established grace through faith right from the beginning, and that was his plan until Israel murmured and complained and said, give us kings and judges to rule over us, because we're always getting in trouble with God. And write down what you want us to do, and he'll leave us alone. See? In sum and substance, that's what they said. I'm paraphrasing. Okay? So they didn't enter his rest. See? Now here, he says, we who have believed enter that rest. So he's showing them it is still possible, and it is possible not on the basis of whether you're Jew or Greek or Jew or Gentile, but on the basis of belief or trust. See? On the basis of trust. So here, Paul is instructing them in chapters 1 and 2. He showed them the preeminence of Christ and the greatness of Christ. And now in chapters 3 and 4, he's trying to instruct them on how to take possession of entering God's rest. You see? How to have that peace with God that they have so, for such a long time, desired, but have always seemed to get in trouble with God. See? And he continues in verse 4. For he has thus said somewhere concerning the seventh day, and God rested on the seventh day from all of his works. And 5, and again in this passage, they shall not enter my rest. So, in verse 1, he tells us, in this is Hebrews chapter 4. No. Verse 5, and again in this passage, they shall not enter my rest.
Why is this they shall
not? No, it's they shall not.
Shall they shall not? Shall
yes.
Not.
Yeah.
No, they should be
yeah.
Shall not.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So now, in verse 1, Paul establishes entering God's rest is still available for everyone, including the Jew. In verse 2 and 3, he says how it is received. It is received by belief or trust or faith. Okay? Belief or trust or faith. All right? Now turn for a moment, keep your hand on that page, and go for a moment to 1 Thessalonians 2:13. And let me just show you something. It's back a few books from Hebrews. 1 Thessalonians 2, verse 13. Say, by faith they entered his rest. Faith, trust, and belief all mean the same thing, huh? Now look at verse 2:13. 1 Thessalonians 2:13. And for this reason, we also constantly thank God that when you received from us the word of God's message, you accepted it not as the word of men, but for what it really is, the word of God, which also performs its work in you who believe. In you who believe. See, that was their problem. They didn't believe. Say, that performs its work in you who believe. Okay? Now, go to 2 Thessalonians, the next book, again chapter 2, again verse 13. But we should always give thanks to God for you, brethren, beloved by the Lord, because God has chosen you from the beginning for salvation through sanctification by the Spirit and faith in the truth.
Praise God.
See? They were chosen to enter God's rest. See? Along with the Gentile. How? through faith, through sanctification by the Spirit and faith in the truth. The truth is a person, and his name is Jesus. See? Okay? So here, in verse 2 and 3, he says in verse 1, entering God's rest is still available to you. In verse 2 and 3, he says it's done by faith. Okay? And it's also done, read now verse 6, since therefore it remains for some to enter it, and those who formerly had good news preached to them failed to enter because of disobedience. He again fixes a certain day, today, saying through David, verse 7, after so long a time, just as has been said before, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. Okay? Now, what he's saying here is that this is not only by faith, but by decree. By decree. God in his sovereignty, in other words, in his sovereignty, he has said in verse 6, since therefore it remains for some to enter into it. In other words, it is still possible. See? In other words, he has decreed it. See? So it is by faith and it is by decree that the Jews can still enter into God's rest along with the Gentiles. Are y'all with me? Okay. In verse 8 it said, for if Joshua had given them rest, he would not have spoken of another day after that. There remains, therefore, a Sabbath rest for the people of God. See? There remains yet a Sabbath rest for the people of God. See? Now, they had already missed entering God's rest when they got into disobedience in the wilderness, hadn't they? You see? We have a rest, a Sabbath rest, yet to enter into when we get home in glory. See? It says, on the seventh day, God rested. Okay? Well, you all know what that refers to, do you not? That everything in biblical history occurs in the 7 days of the Lord. Do y'all know that? Okay. The Old Testament scripture says one day is as 1,000 years. Okay. One day is as 1,000 years. From the creation to Moses was 2,000 years. Okay. Or 2 days of the Lord. We're talking about everything in biblical history occurs in what is called the week of the Lord, 7 days. Okay, 1 day is 1,000 years. Okay, now from creation to Moses was 2,000 years, that's 2 days of the Lord. From Moses to Christ is 2,000 years, that's 2 more days of the Lord, or 4 days of the Lord. Which is, if you ever wondered why Paul said the New Testament scripture, brethren, we are in the last days. You remember him saying that at the time of Christ? And people scratch and they say, well, here it is 2,000 years later, Christ still hasn't come. Why did Paul say, brethren, we're in the last days? The reason he said it was because 4 of the 7 days of the Lord had already passed. You see, the week of the Lord was over, half over. That's why he said that, see? So from the birth of Jesus to the year 1000 is another day, that's 5 days of the Lord. Huh? From the year 1000 to the year 2000 is the 6th day of the Lord, right? The completion of the 6th day of the Lord, right? And it says, and on the 7th day, God rested. So the 7th day will begin when Christ defeats the Antichrist. You see? And peace comes to the earth. Okay? The seventh day then will be the 1,000-year reign of Jesus on the earth, the millennial reign. Okay? Are y'all with me? So that's the seventh day of the Lord. Okay? And the fact that he isn't here right now means that the sixth day is not completed, which therefore means that the 1,000-year period from the true year 1,000 to the true year 2,000 has not yet been completed, right? Otherwise, Christ would be here, wouldn't he?
Right.
You see? Although he reserves the right to tarry, the scripture says. Okay? The word tarry is Old English, which means delay, right? Why? So that the maximum number of people can hear the gospel and the maximum number of people can be saved. Saved. And do you think Christ might tarry? I think he might. Yeah. Knowing his heart for man. Yes. I do. Okay? So, the seventh day is the Sabbath rest. See? And Paul says here in verse... where was I?
Seven? No, 11.
11. No. It had to do with... nine. There remains, therefore, a Sabbath rest, say, for the people of God. Now, that's spiritually as well as earthly. Okay? See, the Sabbath rest for the Israelites was supposed to be Canaan land. See? And when Moses led them out of Israel, they were supposed to go out of Canaan land. They were supposed to go out of Egypt. When Moses, when Moses led them out of Egypt, they were supposed to go into Canaan land, which is a type of entering God's rest, the promised land. Okay? And it was supposed to be an 11-day journey. But they never got there for 40 years because of unbelief and disobedience. Can you imagine? See? They had taken the mixed multitude with them, which didn't help. They intermarried. Okay? Which didn't help their belief. Right? And what ended up happening was they started murmuring and complaining. Where have you taken us, Moses? We don't have enough food. And back in Egypt, we had a chicken in every pot. Huh? Okay? But we didn't have, you know, we don't have enough food. What are we going to wear? Where's the water going to come from? What are we going to feed our kids? God had just done the biggest miracle in existence for them by parting the Red Sea and making a way for them. Huh? And they had already forgotten the miracle. They had been in bondage in Egypt for 470 years. They had already forgotten that. See that? And they had already gotten their eyes off of God and onto man. Moses, how come you can't solve our problems? Take us back. See? And because of all of that, they went 40 years in the wilderness. And then at the beginning, I think it's of Deuteronomy, God says, you've gone around the mountain long enough, head north. He had to tell them the way. To find their way. See, now what was the problem? See, they had not entered God's rest, and they would not trust God, and they were disobedient and in unbelief in the wilderness, and that led them into a wilderness experience. See? And what Paul's trying to tell them here is you have your own wilderness experience, even though they were your ancestors. You still have unbelief and you still have disobedience and you are still wandering around in your own personal wilderness looking for a Messiah. Okay? And here is how it's done. And he talks to them about entering God's rest. See, in other words, getting saved. See, that's what this is all about here. Okay, now he goes on and he says in verse 10, for the one who has entered his rest has himself also rested from his works as God did from his. Wow, this is really important. Really, really important. Okay, this establishes that the Christian faith walk is not a walk of self-effort.
Amen.
It is a walk of grace. In other words, it isn't do, do, do.
That's right.
See, it's done, done, done. Okay?
God,
yeah. And here is the reason why. He says, those who have entered his rest have himself also rested from his own works, as God did from his. Say, in other words, they feed from the tree of life and not from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. See, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil is works. The tree of life is Jesus. I am the way, the truth, and the life. John 14, 6, huh? No man goes to the Father but through me, right? I am the way, the truth, and the life. So if we look at typology in Genesis chapter 1, what we see is that the tree of life represented Jesus, okay? Now the tree of the knowledge of good and evil was something different, wasn't it? And God warned him about it and said, don't eat of that tree. For the day that you eat of that tree, you will surely die. Well, what is the tree of the knowledge of good and evil? It's the tree that gives you knowledge from above, that which is good, and evil, that which is from the earthly. So it's a mixture. Okay? So the tree of the knowledge of good and evil will instruct you, and it will say to you, this is good, do this, and that is bad, don't do that. That is good, do that, and this is bad, don't do this. And so you will start walking a faith walk of your own effort, and you will start thinking, I can do this and I can't do that. I can do this and I can't do that. And before you know it, you're walking along in your faith walk, getting very comfortable that you have codified your existence and your faith walk. And as you're going along, you're developing rules and regulations of what you can do and what you can't do. What you can do and what you can't do. And what is rules and regulations? Religion.
Law.
Say, law is religion. Say, this was the mistake of the Israelites, why they didn't enter into God's rest. They were feeding from the wrong tree, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. See, at the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, they could know about Jesus, but they could never know Jesus, because Jesus is at the tree of life. At the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, they could know about faith, but they could never know true faith, because that's at the tree of life. At the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, they could know about the transforming power of the work of the cross, but they could never know the transforming power of the work of the cross, because that's at the tree of life. See? So, at the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you're stuck in religion. See, you go to religious churches, and they know about Jesus, and they know about what he did on the cross, okay? But a lot of them don't know Jesus, and they don't know the transforming power of the work of the cross. Why? Because they're feeding from the wrong tree. So what happens is this. Now watch this, because it's important. How can you enter God's rest by feeding at the tree of the knowledge of good and evil? Because if you're doing this and avoiding that and doing that and avoiding this, then your transformation is coming from outside of yourself. You're the one doing the work to try to transform yourself, because of the fact that you're following law, rules and regulations, what I can do and what I can't do. And this is going to make me better if I don't do this. And it's going to make me good if I do that. See? And that's what religion tells you. Okay? But guess what? He who is in Christ Jesus is a new creation. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are made new. Okay? Christ in me, the hope of glory. Huh? After you have suffered a while, the God of all grace, he will perfect, deliver, settle, and establish you. Who will do it? He will do it. 1 Peter 5:10. Huh? He shall perfect all things concerning me. Psalm 138, verse 8. Huh? Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens me. Who will strengthen you? He will do it. Huh? Philippians 2:13. It is God who is at work in you to do his will and good pleasure. Who will do it? He will do it. Say. Okay? Which means what, therefore? If all of the scriptures point to the fact that it is Christ who is doing it in you and through you, that's tree of life. Which means what? That God's way, entering his rest, means or implies transformation from within. See? Christ in me, the hope of glory. See? I die daily, Paul says. John says, I must decrease that he may increase. Huh? And Paul says in 2 Corinthians 4:10, his life, my body. Ah. His life. In other words, none of me and all of him. Then I have entered into his rest. None of me and all of him. Say. So at the tree of life, if I'm feeding from that tree, once I enter into salvation, okay, Psalm 46 verse 10 says, cease striving and know that I am God. Wow. Cease striving. Quit the works. That's what that means. See, it's old Hebrew, but, you know, quit the works stuff. See? And know that I am God. See? All right? So the purpose of the tree of the knowledge. See, people had the idea that the tree of the knowledge of good and evil was evil. No. The tree of the knowledge of good and evil wasn't evil. The tree of the knowledge of good and evil was in the garden of God. And nothing unholy could be in the garden of God. See? It wasn't evil. Okay? It was put there for a purpose. And what was the purpose? The purpose was to point you to the tree of life. And God even gave them the instruction. Don't eat of this tree. It exists, but go over there and eat out of that. See, because when you eat of this, you will surely die. See, religion will kill you. See, it doesn't matter what kind of religion it is. Okay? And you need to know this also. Religious people always resist the Holy Spirit. Wrong tree. See? Religious people always resist the Holy Spirit. Okay? And by the way, there are most of them, not all of them, some are very good people, I know some of them, and I'm friends with some of them, okay? And I'm hoping for their salvation, and that they will walk over to the other tree in due time. Okay? But the vast majority of them are mean. It happens to be a fact of history. You know, it was religious people that killed Jesus. Huh? Was religious people that were responsible for the 400 years of the Inquisition. See? It's religious people today who are behind terrorism. See? Religious people always resist the Holy Spirit. See? And are among the meanest people in the world. That's just an observation of history. I'm not saying that to be critical. That's what history shows. Okay? They've been behind a lot of nasty things. Jesus says, a good tree brings forth good fruit and an evil tree brings forth evil fruit. A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit and an evil tree cannot bring forth good fruit. Put the axe to the root. See? The Acts refers to the anointing. Say. Okay? And so what we're saying in all of this is that Paul was trying to show them, okay, that what they were doing is they were caught up in law, and law is the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Say. Notice what Paul says. The law is righteous and the law is holy, he said. The law is good. See, only good things could be in the garden of God, including the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. You see? But notice what he went on to say. But through the law, I came to know sin, and I lusted, and lust birthed death in me. See? So here's something which is holy and righteous, but which will birth death in you. See? And what did the Lord say to Adam and Eve? The day you eat of that tree, you will surely die. See? You will surely die. Because he's not at that tree. See? You know, let me just digress a moment and say something to you. Old Testament is law, but few people realize that New Testament is law also. How do you know that? Because Jesus says the word cannot be divided. The word cannot, some of your translations say the word cannot be broken. In other words, you cannot separate Old Testament from New Testament. Old Testament is New Testament concealed. New Testament is Old Testament revealed. Okay? But it is all one unit. It's all law. See? People don't realize that. See? People have said to me, where is the tree of the knowledge of good and evil today? You're holding it in your hands. See? What is its purpose? To point you to Christ. What was the purpose of the tree, the knowledge of good and evil in the Garden of Eden? To point you to Christ. See? Why? What's the difference? Tree of the knowledge of good and evil represents logos word. Tree of life represents rhema word. See? If you look at Jeremiah 1:12 in the Septuagint translation of the Bible, that's the Old Testament written in Greek for the Hellenistic Jews of Greece who didn't speak Hebrew. And you look at Jeremiah 1:12 in the Greek of the Old Testament Septuagint translation. You have done well, Jeremiah. I am watching over my word to perform it. The word in the Greek that the Holy Spirit used there for word is not logos, it's rhema. I am watching over my rhema to perform it. See, there's a difference. Because rhema revelation comes off of the page. See, this is of no use to you whatsoever unless it becomes rhema.
Amen. True.
It's got to become rhema.
Amen.
The rhema is the revealed word behind the written word. The true spiritual meaning behind what is written here. See, otherwise it's like Jesus said, parables. I talk to them in parables because the kingdom is not open to them. See? Okay? And that's the way you could end up with this book if you don't pray the Holy Spirit to give you the revelation, the rhema behind the logos. See? The logos is the written word, and it comes to you horizontally from the page. Okay? But the rhema is the revealed word behind the written word. The true meaning, see? Behind the written word. Okay? And that comes vertically down upon you through the anointing by the Holy Spirit. See? So rhema operates vertically in communication with the Spirit of God. You see? Logos operates horizontally. And we have people who are preaching, you know, week after week after week after week after week, year after year after year after year, in non-spirit-filled churches, the Logos Word of God. Okay, when in actuality, it's rhema word that they need, because rhema brings transformation. Revelation brings transformation, not persuasion. That's soulish. Jesus says the things of the Spirit are spirit. Huh? Therefore, it's rhema revelation that brings transformation. Huh? Okay? And so this is why Paul was trying to say to them there is a place of rest. Say. And that place of rest is in the revelation and salvation of Christ, tree of life, tree of life. And he's been trying to say to them, you have all missed it because for years and years and years, you have been insistent on feeding from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, which is law. See, tree of the knowledge of good and evil represents law. Tree of life represents grace. Tree of the knowledge of good and evil represents works. Tree of life represents faith or trust. Say, tree of the knowledge of good and evil represents transformation from without. Tree of life represents transformation from within. Say. And so Paul was saying that if you want to enter God's rest, you must go to the tree of life. Because entering God's rest is salvation. Entering God's rest is peace with God. And the only way that you can have that peace with God is to enter a covenant with Him. So ultimately, entering God's rest is true covenant in the blood of Christ. You see? In which there is salvation, healing, and deliverance, because that word in the Greek, sozo, from which the word soteria comes also, okay? That word in the Greek not only means salvation, it also means healing, and it also means deliverance. See? And so for that reason, Paul takes the time here in this chapter, we've only gotten through half of it, we'll have to continue in our next session. But he goes through these points, and I try to expound upon them, okay, to show you what Paul's reasoning was. He could clearly see what they were doing. Say, they had gone to the wrong tree. They'd made the same mistake Adam and Eve made. Say, and they had been persuaded differently. And they thought that it was by works, and that it was by religion, and that it was by keeping the law, that they were going to be justified by God, and they did not understand that that is not God's way. God's way always was grace by faith. And they did not enter in, it says at the beginning of this chapter, because they did not use faith. So what was the problem? They fell into unbelief and disobedience because they were doing it by works and not by faith. See? So he says to them to give them hope. There is a rest to be entered into. In other words, you can still do it, but this is what you have to do. You've got to change your heart, because the scripture says, harden not your heart. See? And that was their problem. Religious people have a hardness of heart which prevents them from being persuaded otherwise of what they are doing wrong. Amen. They're among the toughest people in the world to witness to. I don't know whether you've ever tried, but it's a real experience. Say, the Holy Spirit, in fact, when you do witness to them, you should pray ahead of time, Holy Spirit, prepare their heart and mind to receive. Say, and sometimes, if they don't resist the Holy Spirit, you can get a breakthrough there. And that's happened to me several times in the past. I think we're going to stop there for tonight, and then we'll continue this discussion about entering God's rest in our next session. Father, we give you thanks, praise, and glory for the revelation of your Spirit. We thank you, Lord, that you show us that what was always meant for man was to walk and talk with you directly in the cool of the afternoon, just as you did originally with Adam and Eve, Lord. That the law was given, the scripture was given because man asked for it. but it was never your way, Lord. Covenant revelation was always your way, Lord. And we thank you that you are bringing the church back and raising the remnant to that relationship which you originally intended for the entire body of the called out ones. We bless your name and we give you all the glory. And the saints said in agreement, amen. Amen. Anybody want to ask any questions?
I'm wondering why we don't still, well, why don't we rest on the seventh day?
Well, the answer to that's very simple. Number one, we're not lawkeepers. Okay? Number two, Christ established that man was not made for the Sabbath. The Sabbath was made for man. Okay? And number three, and most important, Paul develops the idea in the book of Hebrews that we are continually Sabbathing with the Lord. See? Go ahead.
Can I ask something? Yeah. You know, thing is that we need to see that there is a lot of figures in the scripture. And what he's talking about, salvation, the true rest is being saved. Because when you're saved, you surrender.
You surrender, exactly.
You surrender. I think the whole deal about being a hardened of heart or not being hardened of heart is that when you surrender, you stop being hard. You surrender to the Lord.
Yes.
You let him have his way. You know, in Romans 12 says that in view of God's mercy, present our bodies as a sacrifice, and then we will renew our way of thinking. Because we always have thought that we can do it. There is a way that I can do it. And that's part of the problem that they have, you know. They learn that keeping the law, they will keep God at peace.
They still have.
I know, but to this point, and he is saying here, no. It was that, you know, when they entered into the promised land, Joshua will give them the rest then, but they didn't get the rest.
That's right.
The celebration of the Shabbat, or the Sabbath, is a figure to show them that it's a rest that God gives.
That's right.
But it doesn't mean that we need to rest in the Sabbath day, you know. But it's a spiritual rest.
Exactly.
It's rest to me trying to impress God that God accepts me.
Yes.
I'm trying to impress God. I'm doing this, I'm doing that. You remember one time, there was this guy that was a new believer, you know, a couple of years, and one day he talked to another guy, you know, see me now, you know, I'm doing this, and working this, and helping this. Many things he was helping in the church, you know. But I heard you say that, I heard it, that he had a guy. You think about more he does, he's like, yes, he's good that he helped, and that's good for the ministry. But is that he's doing bad in his heart because he's trusting in what he does.
Amen.
You know what Jesus did for him.
Absolutely.
And then when we, if we, on the other hand, I think God wants us to rest one day of the week. That's just because we need to rest. Our body needs to rest. Our emotions, you know, we have to take a break of work.
It can be any day we choose.
Yes.
Sure.
I usually rest on Mondays.
Legalism is law.
I usually rest on Mondays because as pastor,
legalism is law.
Monday is the day that I'm after the weekend.
You have to rest.
I rest on Monday. Why?
Yeah. Yeah. A lot of pastors do. Yeah.
You know, some like to rest on Friday to be ready for the weekend. You know?
Yeah.
But you know, whatever. But the point is that it's not the day. It's the day that is more convenient for you. But the important thing is that you rest, because you need rest in that sense. But in a spiritual way, the way you rest is not stop doing, not just doing nothing. You wait, you rest spiritually, trusting in Jesus.
Yes, exactly.
That's what he's talking about here, because some of these people, they were Jews, that at one point they were believing in Jesus, they were trying to return to the traditions, because there was a lot of peer pressure in Israel, in Jerusalem specifically, about, you know, they were believers in Jesus Christ, but then their families reject him, and everybody, that was, you know, you read the book, you see, they talk about being rejected, because they were like the Messianic Jews now, you know, that they are rejected by their families because they believe in Jesus.
Yeah.
That's the same thing. Because normal, it's normal.
But they're legalistic.
Yes. They go in, the Judaism is legalistic, it's based on laws. And what he was talking about is that some Christians, a lot of Christians, they make law of the New Testament, because the New Testament has more commandments than the Old Testament.
It does.
Wow, really?
Jesus, you know, in the New Testament there are about 1150 commandments.
Wow.
But then, you know, because God, you know, a lot of the books is, you know, in the New Testament, the letters are books to correction. Don't do this. Stop doing that.
That's
you
right.
Should keep
yeah.
doing this. This, that is bad. What he did so and so is bad, and then it's going to happen.
Sure.
Yes.
Yeah.
You know what I think the most beautiful thing about God's rest is that even in the midst of adversity, you have a peace and a calm, knowing that the end is okay. It's okay.
That's the real rest. The real rest is not
to me, that's,
nothing.
That's, you know.
Is that my heart is at peace with God because I surrender.
Yeah, it's true.
That's exactly right.
And that's
yeah.
when you get tested,
yeah.
when you
yeah,
get into adversity.
How would you define the church?
Well, the first thing you need to know is that the word church does not exist in the New Testament.
Uh-huh.
Huh.
Okay, that's the first thing you need to know. Okay, the word church is an innovation of the King James translation. And they got it from Augustine and Jerome, okay, who were two early Roman Catholic Bible scholars that lived around the year 350 to 400, okay? The actual word in the Greek, ecclesia, okay, E-C-C-L-E-S-I-A, ecclesia, has been loosely translated by the King James translators as church. But the actual definition in the original Koine Greek, Koine, is the common people's Greek. The New Testament was written in Koine Greek, okay? And the word ecclesia in Koine is literally translated the called out ones, say. And the church is defined in Ephesians 1, verse 22 and 23. As the body of believers. In other words, it is a spiritual entity made up of the called out ones, okay? It is referred to in the true church in the scripture is referred to as the remnant, say. And why is the true church referred to as the remnant? Because God, if you study the history of scripture, you will see that from the time of Enoch to the present, God has taken aside and called out the called out ones. He has called out a remnant of people, okay, who have walked faithfully without compromise. Christ alone, by grace alone, through faith alone, by the word, the water, and the blood alone, and no doctrines of men. Say, and that is called the remnant in Scripture. And it fulfills Matthew 6:33, seek first the kingdom and his righteousness, all else will be given you besides.
Matthew
6:33. See, seek first the kingdom and his righteousness. In other words, God's standard is his righteousness alone, which is the word, right? His righteousness alone. See, that's his standard, okay? Which disqualifies denominational people from being remnant because, you see, they are walking in his righteousness plus man's righteousness, which is what makes a denomination what it is.